Hi guys, this video is in partnership with BetterHelp. If you're a kitten foster parent, you know that animal rescue comes along with a lot of emotional challenges, and it can help to have somebody to talk to. BetterHelp can assess your needs and match you with a licensed professional therapist. They offer professional counseling done securely online, and they can match you with therapists with a broad range of expertise so that no matter where you are in the world, you can get the help that you need. You just log on, send a message to your counselor, and you'll get thoughtful and timely responses. Plus, you can schedule weekly video or phone sessions so that you don't have to go and wait in a waiting room ever again, like with traditional therapy. BetterHelp makes it easy to change counselors so you can find the match that's right for you, and it's more affordable than traditional in-person therapy. BetterHelp wants you to start living a happier life, and I do too. I'm so grateful to them for partnering with me to talk about the emotional side of rescue. And right now they are giving viewers 10% off your first month when you visit betterhelp.com/kitten. So a lot of people assume that fostering is all about cuddles and cuteness, and there certainly is a lot of that, but there's also this other side to it, this side that is sometimes difficult and emotional and harder to talk about. And in this video, I want to talk about it and let you know that if you're an animal rescuer and you experience any of these things, you're not alone. It's okay to acknowledge that sometimes fostering kittens is really hard. When I was starting to think about what I wanted to say in this video, I had some ideas of the things that are hardest for me personally in animal rescue, but I wanted to see what other people's experiences were too. So I asked online, you know, hey, if you're a foster parent, what do you think is the most difficult part of fostering emotionally? And I was just so overwhelmed by the responses because it really all boiled down to like a handful of really commonly shared experiences that we all go through. And I was like almost in tears reading it because I just think foster parents, we are so strong and we are so compassionate, and in saving lives, we are, you know, sometimes exposing ourselves to things that can be really challenging. So I want to talk about some of the things that are the most common emotional experiences for foster parents, and my personal experiences with those. And I hope that I can offer some insight into the ways that I cope with the hard stuff. I think it is always a journey. So I want to start with talking about adoption, because that's something that a lot of people have a hard time with is, you know, you raise this kitten and you get them to a place where they are healthy and ready to go home, and then you have to say goodbye to them. And I definitely understand that feeling of like, oh my gosh, how can I possibly part with this animal? I think especially if you are newer to fostering, that can feel really scary and unfamiliar and like almost counterintuitive that you could love someone so much and then say goodbye to them. Even 12 years into fostering, I still sometimes cry when I'm preparing to adopt out a kitten. It's an emotional thing. So what I want to say about that is if you feel emotional about your adoptions, that's totally okay. Like, it is absolutely normal and totally fine if you cry about adoption, if you feel very emotional saying goodbye to your foster kittens. You know, you feel emotional because you love them. And if you didn't love them, and if you didn't have those strong emotions about them, then you wouldn't be so cut out for fostering, would you? You know, it's those of us who have those big hearts and all of those big feelings that make really good foster parents, because we love them a lot. Now, what helps me a lot is to frame it not as falling in love with an individual kitten, but falling in love with the entire cycle of fostering. What I mean by that is that, you know, the entire purpose of this is getting these little kittens in when they're sick and frail and they need us so much, and then getting them to a place where they don't need us anymore, helping them meet their new best friend, finding their loving home, and having a space for the next kitten who needs you. for me, I'm able to kind of fall in love with the entire cycle and know that helping somebody meet their new best friend means that that kitten can move on and I can save a spot for the next kitten who needs me so very much. So focusing on my goals is just really helpful for me. It's why I always say goodbye is the goal. You kind of go into it with that framework of knowing, okay, the entire point is that it's a cycle. And if we go into fostering with that framework that the entire goal is goodbye, then goodbye becomes a celebration. And that's what adoption really should be, is a celebration of all that you've accomplished, you and the kitten together. So for me, even if I'm feeling a little bit emotional saying goodbye to the kitten, I try to almost trick myself into feeling really positively about it by saying, okay, we're gonna throw an adoption party, I'm gonna put a little hat on your head, we're gonna make this a really happy celebration. And it can be emotional then, the same way that like a graduation is emotional, you know? You're emotional because you've achieved something. I think it's good to lean into being in touch with those emotions. Love is a beautiful thing. Doesn't mean that we need to keep all of our foster kittens, but that love is what makes you an awesome foster parent. So for me, that's one that I do get emotional about, but I don't have quite as hard of a time with. What I have a lot harder of a time with is the sad goodbyes. The goodbyes that are not the types of goodbyes I want. And that is, you know, when a kitten passes away. Unfortunately, when you do animal rescue, you are going to be exposed to some amount of death and grief. And that is a much harder one for me. I would much rather have those happy goodbyes than the sad ones where it doesn't go the way you want it to. This year has been challenging, I think, for a lot of rescuers, and it certainly has been for me. I've lost a couple of foster kittens this year, and I wish I could say that that one gets a lot easier, but I think it never does get easy to lose a kitten who you love. My feeling about grief is that there is not one right way to grieve. Everybody grieves differently, and so when I lose a kitten, what I try to do is really just be true to myself, listen to myself. What do I need in that moment? Sometimes I need to talk to somebody. A lot of the time I need to talk to somebody. And for me, what helps is talking to somebody who I think will really understand me. Because sometimes people don't know what to say, and that's okay. But it can be really helpful to have community you can lean on who really understand what you're going through. So I like to talk to other foster parents, other people who have had a similar experience to mine. Sometimes that is the most helpful thing for me. And then there are other times where in that moment, in that crisis moment, like I just need to be distracted. Earlier this year, I lost a kitten to panleukopenia and I was just so exhausted after days and days of working with this kitten and, you know, trying so hard and barely sleeping, and it didn't go my way and the kitten passed away and I was just drained and I didn't want to talk about it in that moment. You know, what I wanted to do was put on sweatpants, hop in bed and like watch, you know what I wanted to watch was Mary Poppins, like the original Mary Poppins with Dick Van Dyke. So good. I haven't seen it like since I was a kid. And I was like, I just need like a comforting thing to escape into for a couple hours. And that's what I did. And that's okay. You know, if that's the way that you need to deal with that in the moment, that's totally okay. Everybody deals with grief differently. So I think that the important thing about grief is knowing it is going to happen sometimes. You're not alone in that. And whatever you need to do is okay. A piece of advice is to express what you need to other people because they don't always know. You know, sometimes you might have a friend who assumes that you want to talk about it and they bring it up randomly, or they send you a picture of the kitten when you weren't expecting it and it's hurtful, you know? So the only way that people know how to be kind to you in that moment is for you to express to them what you need. And it's okay if that changes from day to day. You know, something else that really helps me when I'm grieving is to focus on the lessons that I've learned through that kitten, because the truth is there's not a single kitten I've lost who has not taught me something that has saved another kitten. And I think for me, that kind of goes back to understanding that cycle of what you're really doing. You know, you're getting kittens in, you're bringing them to a place where they're healthy enough to be adopted, you're adopting them out. sometimes it does not go the way that you want it to, but every single one of those things that you experience is a learning opportunity that helps you be stronger in the future. And so even when things don't go the way that we want them to, you know, we learn so very much. Most important is please try to question and challenge any feelings of guilt that pop up for you. A lot of people say that when they lose a kitten, they feel guilty, and that just breaks my heart. I can't tell you how to feel. Like, you're gonna feel how you're gonna feel, but it just breaks my heart because you're only guilty of trying to give love and opportunity to an animal. You know, it is not your fault if you lose an animal. And sometimes that happens, and all we can do is learn from it. You know, even when I have those feelings, which do pop up, of like, oh, I could have done something different. Maybe if I had done this, it would have gone a different way. I try not to like stay focused on like, I wish I had done this, because that makes me very closed and it makes me scared and not want to move on, versus having that feeling of like, okay, here's something I learned that I can try in the future. And that makes me much more open. It makes me much more curious. What will I be able to do now with this knowledge? So please try to challenge any of those, I wish I had, what if I had done this? You know, I think if we can focus on the future and like, what can I take from this experience so that I can do something amazing in the future? I mean, that really helps me. You know, the same goes for dealing with sick kittens, you know, when they are alive, it can feel like, oh my gosh, it is so draining. Like, I have that going on right now. Literally right now, I'm working with this kitten who has been sick for weeks and weeks and weeks, and I feel like I'm on this treadmill I can't get off of. It's like, I'm doing all of the things, I'm trying so hard, I'm, you know, up in the middle of the night for weeks just trying to help this kitten. And do I know if it's gonna go the way I want? I don't know. Like, sometimes it feels like all you can do is try. So dealing with these difficult medical cases is something we all go through. I think what helps me a lot is to be open to learning all the time and to be really eager to learn. I try to reach out to anyone I can who may be able to help me. You know, I will message a complete stranger on the internet or cold call a clinic and just say, hey, you know, it seems like you might have experience with this that might be helpful to me. Are you willing to chat with me for a couple minutes? It can make a huge, huge, huge difference when you feel like you're not alone, because other people are doing the work that you're doing. Other people are out there who would love to talk to you and help you understand something new. I mean, I can't imagine knowing anything that I know without having a community to lean on and having other people that I can ask. So when you're dealing with those medical cases, just know that you don't have to do that alone. Obviously, you have the veterinarian that you're working with, you have, you know, your foster team. You can contact people who have that experience. And what helps me about that is then I know that I'm turning every stone that I can. And sometimes there isn't an answer. If it doesn't go the way that I want it to, then at least I know that I really tried so hard and I learned so much. But man, it is hard, you know? And you can't let anybody tell you that it's not. And you can't let anybody tell you you're being too sensitive. I mean, I get that sometimes. People tell me I'm being too sensitive or too emotional about my kittens. And it's like, you don't get to tell somebody what's appropriate to be emotional about, you know? This is hard stuff. And even if there are foster animals, we still love them like they're our own. Because while they're with us, I mean, we are their home. We are their lifeline. You just have to know that that is a huge thing to take on, and that that is a very brave thing to take on. Like, if you're doing this work, you're so incredibly brave. So, I mean, we gotta go easy on ourselves. We've got to be able to grow community and support each other and feel like somebody has our back. I mean, I'm gonna keep saying it, but talking to people really, really helps. I know rescue people are always like, oh, I love animals. I don't love talking to people, but like, there are other people who are in your shoes who can help you, whether that is lending an empathetic ear or providing you with some kind of information that can help the kitten that you're working with. I don't know, for me, that really helps. Now, the other thing I want to talk about that I think is a very commonly shared experience for rescuers is the feeling of pressure to do more. I mean, if you're a rescuer, you know what I'm talking about, right? there's so much pressure to do more and more and more. And that pressure comes from other people, for sure. It comes from other people, but it also comes from within ourselves. Because I think what happens is, you know, when you get involved in kitten fostering, you're on the lists, you're in the community, you start to see how big the issue is, and suddenly your eyes are opened to how great of a need there is. And you're like, okay, well, if I can say yes to one, then maybe I can say yes to five. And if I can say yes to five, maybe I can say yes to 20. And pretty soon you have like way too much going on. You're not taking breaks. You're taking on too many animals. You're taking on too many difficult cases in a row where you're not sleeping. You're not taking care of yourself. I mean, you know what I'm talking about, right? Like, I have experienced this, I mean, so many times. And I have worked really hard to find my boundaries, but I have to say, like, I find my boundaries by crossing them. Like, I find them by stepping over the line and going, whoa, okay, that's what it feels like to have taken on way too much. And, you know, we suffer when we take on too much, and the animals suffer when we take on too much, because nobody can do everything and do it really well. So I think it's very important for animal rescuers to know their capacity and to find that line and then take like several steps back from it. Because you don't have to be operating at 110% all the time. You don't even have to be operating at 80% all the time. Like, it's okay if sometimes you do a lot and sometimes you do nothing and sometimes you just do a little. And nobody gets to tell you how much you should be doing. I think as a community, we sometimes are very all or nothing. Like, you either have to be doing as much as you can all the time and like setting your life on fire for the animals, or you have to quit. You know, this is a thing that happens, is people do so much and then they burn out and then they quit. And that doesn't help anybody, you know? I mean, I have a lot of respect for people who realize that this is not for them and that they need to take a step back. But what I wish is that we could kind of appreciate that balance a little bit more and really like celebrate when people kind of just do what's within their capacity, including ourselves, you know? And like, that's advice that I even need to hear, because sometimes I feel like I just have to like do more and do more and do more and do more. But I try to remember, I really try to remember to take my own advice and to realize that, you know, sometimes when I take a day to just go to the beach, like, I'm actually helping animals because I need to be taken care of in order for me to be able to take care of others. You know, you have to care for the caregiver, because if you're not okay and you're the one who's taking care of animals, then what's going to happen to them? Right? I think, again, this goes back to that cycle. You know, we want people to be doing this in a sustainable way, picking up the knowledge that they can, using it to save more lives, but doing it in a way that has a little bit of flow to it, has a little bit of balance to it. Because the longer you do this, the more skills you will pick up. And so, you know, we want people to stick around, and burning everyone out is not going to make them stick around. Also, who wants to join a movement where everybody is exhausted and miserable? Like, I don't want to have a miserable life. I want to have a balanced life. I'll be the first to admit I don't have a balanced life. Like, I definitely, when people say to me, like, oh, what are your hobbies outside of animal rescue? I'm like, outside of animal rescue? What are you talking about? You know, but I try. That is a discipline for me. For me, it is a discipline. I have to say, okay, it's a Saturday. Perhaps I should go on a hike today. Perhaps I should watch a movie this evening. You know, like, take that as a discipline. And if you feel yourself finding that line or crossing that line, just know that, like, it's not just okay for you to take steps back. It's actually like a beautiful, wonderful thing that we should be commending each other on. So that pressure from within is definitely understandable. It's really hard. I think that is a lifelong journey. For me, I think, unfortunately, the hardest part of all of this is the pressure from other people. And maybe I feel that way because I have a lot of people looking at what I'm doing. Maybe I feel that way because this is just a commonly shared experience that I know we all go through. When you are a rescuer, there is just pressure from all around you that you should be doing more. And, you know, if you really cared, you would say yes to this and this and this. And if you really cared, you would, you know, respond to every single urgent plea that you're tagged in online. Like, I know you guys know what I'm talking about, right? I'm accused every single day by people of not caring because I didn't see a post that they tagged me in, or I didn't, you know, help 100 different kittens who needed me from the shelter that day, you know, but I am one person and you are one person also. And we can't be made to feel guilty just because other people don't understand what our capacity is. You know, you can express a boundary, and I certainly do. You know, I certainly do express boundaries to the people in my immediate life about what I feel like I can handle and what I can't handle. And of course that changes all the time. But there are gonna be people who just don't respect your boundary, who don't understand your capacity, and who think like you should be able to just take on everything. And yeah, I try to take it as a compliment, like, oh, you think I'm like superhuman and that I can just like help every single cat in the world. That's very flattering. But it's understandable that like that just gets really exhausting and kind of sad feeling when every day people are telling you you're not doing enough. That definitely gets to me, and I think it gets to a lot of you too. This is an ongoing thing for me. I am committed to caring less about that, because what I'm finding for myself is that, you know, there is no upper limit to how much I can do and still have people expect me to do more. And so in a way, it's almost like a little bit of an invitation to stop taking so seriously what other people think and to start just measuring my success within myself. Like, okay, do I feel like I'm doing enough? Yeah, I do. Like, I definitely do. Do I feel like I'm doing good work? For sure. You know, do I feel like I'm making a difference and like I'm learning and growing? Do I feel like I'm taking care of myself? Like, ultimately, that is what matters. It's easier said than done to just look within and not listen to what everybody else says. But it is something that I'm definitely working on. I hope that you can work on as well. You know, I could go on and on about this, all of the things that make this really difficult work. But the truth is, at the end of the day, it is rewarding and it is worth it. And I think that we really just have to commit to finding ways to live a good life while helping others have the opportunity to live theirs. And if anybody tells you that you shouldn't be talking about this stuff, genuinely give them a one-way ticket out of your life. I have had people try to tell me, oh, compassion fatigue isn't real. Oh, rescuers are just being too sensitive. And it's like, please. Usually that is from people who are not even involved in what you're involved in. They don't have the subject matter expertise to tell you what you should be feeling. So nobody gets to tell you how to feel, and nobody gets to set your boundaries except you. What am I trying to say here? I'm just trying to say I empathize with you fully, and I hope that you will care for yourself, listen to yourself, listen to what you need, and express it to other people unapologetically. If you're doing animal rescue, I appreciate you so much, and I want you to live a happy life. You certainly deserve that.